to share my slides and let's go on with heart failure. As we know that heart failure is something which is silent, which creeps in and which gives all sorts of issues. And in the diabetic, everything is silent. And if we do not help in the diabetic, we are going to be in trouble. So I'm going to mainly talk about SGLT2. Of course, we know that there were two studies, the Emperor Preserved study and the Deliver study. And Emperor Preserved came first with Deliver quickly to follow. In this short period of time for me to talk about both the studies would be difficult, but the conclusion of each of these studies is the same. So I'm going to go on and tell you about one study and collate everything else with the rest. Are my slides visible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. So we all know the universal definition of heart failure. Symptoms, signs of heart failure caused by structural and or functional cardio abnormality and corroborated with at least one of the following: elevated BNP or objective evidence of cardiogenic pulmonary or systemic congestion. We know in the diagnostic algorithm for heart failure, you have to have suspected heart failure. And along with the suspicions, you have to either have NT-proBNP or echo evidence or abnormal findings based on heart failure. And of course, we classify them as less than 40 reduced ejection fraction, 41 to 49 mild reduction in ejection fraction, and more than 50 preserved ejection fraction. Heart failure etiology is extremely important, but today we know we are in diabetes and that's the silent one. We know stage A, stage B, stage C, and stage D, heart failure at risk, pre-heart failure, frank heart failure, and advanced heart failure. Heart failure is twofold more common in men and fivefold more in women with type 2 diabetes. 12% people with type 2 diabetes have heart failure. The prevalence rises with age. And what is interesting, which people forget, and we as clinicians like to remind you, that 3.3% of people with type 2 diabetes develop heart failure each year. And with every evidence and every episode of heart failure, the next episode is more frequent. Even a mere 1% rise in A1C corresponds to 15% increased risk of heart failure. 68% of asymptomatic patients with type 2 diabetes have subclinical heart failure by resting echo. They have structural abnormalities, systolic dysfunction, diastolic dysfunction. So the new universal definition of heart failure is classified according to phenotypes on LVEF, reduced ejection fraction, mildly reduced ejection fraction, and preserved ejection fraction as the numbers denote, and with improved ejection fraction, where heart failure with baseline less than 40, with a more than 10-point increase and second measurement of more than 40 is success to the patient, success to the clinician, and success to therapy. The underlying etiology, we all know, we don't want to get into it. Look at the Asian Heart Failure Registry of Preserved Ejection Fraction, the age, EGFR, etiology, ischemia, coronary arteries, but diabetes mellitus, 68, and CKD. The serendipitous story of SGLT2 inhibition in cardiovascular medicine. Just imagine a drug which came out for diabetes is today ruling supreme as an anti-cardiac or cardiovascular savior. We know that the EMPA-REG outcome clearly shows that EMPA confers early and sustained risk reduction for CV death in patients with type 2 diabetes and atherosclerotic CVD. 38% overall risk reduction, Asian patients, 56% risk reduction. SGLT2 inhibitors and heart failure, they have a three-level effect on left ventricular structure and function. I'm going to dwell a little more into this slide. Remember, SGLT2 works at the kidney level. increases natriuresis, diuresis, glycosuria, and reduces intraglomerular pressure. This reduces cardiac preload. At the heart level, it improves metabolic efficiency, increases oxygen supply, reduces oxidative stress, fibrosis, epicardial fat, and neurohormonal stimulation. This leads to increase in LV diastolic function with decrease in LV mass. And at the vascular level, it increases endothelial function and reduces vascular resistance and arterial wall stiffness, thus reducing cardiac afterload. And all this helps in LV function. If you look at the coding and the decoding of empagliflozin's molecular mechanism of action in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction using artificial intelligence, the most probable cascade mechanism of EMPA in heart failure with preserved ejection fraction with 94% accuracy is the upstream effect, which is cardiomyocyte oxidative stress and systemic inflammation, which it reduces, and the downstream effect, where it numbs the cardiomyocyte stiffness, extracellular matrix remodeling, and reduction in concentric hypertrophy. So EMPA could reverse 59% of protein alterations relevant to HFpEF pathogenesis. The CV relevance of SGLT2 inhibition prior to EMPEROR preserved, the European Society of Cardiology had positional statements for heart failure, type 2 diabetes, high CV risk, and CKD. But now we have post-EMPEROR preserved. What was the study design? Phase 3 trial in patients with HFpEF. And the population was type 2 diabetic and non-type 2 diabetic more than 18 years, chronic heart failure, EGFR more than 20. And the EMPEROR preserved was divided into one group where EMPA 10 was given once a day with a placebo, 6,000 patients, composite primary endpoint, time to first event of adjudicated CV death or adjudicated heart failure, hospitalization, and the confirmatory key secondary points were first and recurrent adjudicated hospitalization through heart failure and the slope of change in EGFR from baseline. The key inclusion-exclusion criteria we have gone through, the inclusion, you must have LVEF more than 40, NT-proBNP more than 300 in patients without AF, and more than 900 in patients with AF, structural changes in the heart or hospitalization for heart failure within 12 months of screening, the usual exclusion criteria of decompensated heart failure, EGFR being very low, and symptomatic patients with recent cardiac intervention. If you look at the characteristics of the patients, it's very clear age was about 71, women were 44%. It was a worldwide study. NYHA class, it was class 2, class 3, which was the major. BMI was quite stocky with about 30 almost. The heart rate was 70. Obviously, the patient was on usual treatment, standard of care for heart failure. And if you look at LVEF, all of them were more than 40. 50 to 60 were 1,000. 40 to 50 were 900, almost 1,000, and more than 60, a little less than 1,000. NT-proBNP, CV history, etiology, all that fitted in. What was seen in these patients? The CV medications were standard of care. Empagliflozin in that arm demonstrated a clinically meaningful 21% relative risk reduction in composite primary endpoint of CV death or HHF. This was very significant, and significant benefit evident from day 18 onwards. Now, this is very quick, day 18 onwards. 21% RRR, 3.3% ARR, and numbers needed to treat as low as 31. Again, if you look at the consistent and meaningful benefit with EMPA across all pre-specified patient subgroups, whether it was all over the world, north, south, east, west, both sexes, with baseline LVEF and diabetic status. Everything was moving to the left of the graph, and the history of atrial fibrillation did not change the result. EMPA reduced risk of first and recurrent hospitalization for heart failure by 27% in a confirmatory secondary endpoint. See placebo, see EMPA, and see the diversion of the graph. It protected the kidney by significantly punctuating, slowing down the decline in kidney function. 1.25 with empagliflozin and 2.62 with placebo. This was really significant. So if you look at the summary of key results for confirmatory outcomes, primary endpoint adjudicated CV death or hospitalization for heart failure, confirmatory. Secondary endpoint, confirmatory. And eGFR slope, which is a key secondary endpoint, also confirmatory. So this was in the Emperor preserved study. If you look at the causes of death in these patients, cardiovascular cause, non-cardiovascular cause, all of them are outlined. And you can see placebo is again much more or almost showing EMPA is non-inferior. If you look at the early and significant improvement in QOL, Kansas City Cardiomyopathy Questionnaire, see the diversion on treatment between EMPA and placebo and all data between EMPA and placebo. Adjusted mean difference of 1.32 and 1.5 if you see both the graphs. An early and significant improvement in symptom improvement, increased likelihood of improvement in NYHA class, where patient migrates from a lower class to a better class, was seen as early as week 12 onwards. Improvement, deterioration, weeks since randomization. You take a drug for sugar and it helps your heart. Kidhar dawa, kidhar disha. Absolutely fantastic. So Emperor preserved selected adverse events which they had were, of course, as is seen, selected AEs of interest, which is usual from hypotension, renal dysfunction, ketoacidosis, UTI, bone fractures, all those that have been known to occur with SGLT2, and there is a word of caution, which all treating physicians now know. So empagliflozin, along here with DAPA, represents first therapy with conclusively proven benefits in patients with heart failure and preserved ejection fraction, regardless of type 2 diabetes mellitus. So here's a drug introduced for diabetes, works on the heart, now given even for non-diabetics for cardiac preservation. So the 2021 study with CV death and HHF showed a very significant 21% risk reduction, and back-to-back on Paragon, Topcat, iPreserve, PepsiHF, and Charm preserved, this really helps the entire cardiac setup. So by consistently lowering the risk of CV death and HF hospitalization, it is in patients across the spectrum of heart failure. Cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure and total hospitalizations for heart failure, Emperor reduced and Emperor preserved. We are not talking about the reduced study, but it was across the spectrum of heart failure. Again, if you look at the preserved and the Paragon heart failure, side-by-side analysis, baseline LV ejection fraction, and CV death or hospitalization, it is so very complementary. And you can see how the blue and the red play a matching role. If you look at the pooled analysis, hospitalizations for heart failure by baseline LV ejection fraction, time to first heart failure and total hospitalization, the post hoc analysis also is in favor and is very significant. So we now know that empagliflozin confers significantly and meaningful CV benefits in patients across the CV risk continuum. And you can see everywhere in patients group, T2DM with low medium risk, T2DM without MI or stroke. So that's EMPA-REG outcome, EMPA-REG with ASCVD, EMPA-REG with preserved EMPEROR EF and EMPEROR reduced. This is an across the board. I think I have exceeded my brief. I hope I haven't taken away my timing and done justice. I again must tell you that I have not shown the deliver slides because they are more or less similar and the work that it tells you is similar. I remember that when this drug came in, we all were very excited and we are continuously getting excited because more and more evidence shows us what a pleiotropic molecule this is, who can bat, bowl, field, and indeed even be a wicket keeper. Thank you for your attention.